Okay, let's move into scripture, shall we? Before we take a look at Ezekiel 19, please join me in prayer. Father, we thank you that you have revealed yourself to us in your holy word, the scriptures, which we call the Bible. It is how you have spoken to us. It is how you speak to us today. And so we thank you that you have done that and that you have opened our eyes and ears to your word. And now we pray that you would give us wisdom in your word, understanding in your word, that you would help us to take your word and put it into action in our lives. Help us be encouraged today. Help us be refilled today. Fill our cups to overflowing today by what we hear in your word and how we're stirred up to love and good works by your word, your Holy Spirit, and by one another. Bless our time together in your word, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Ezekiel 19, this is going to be a lament. This is a lament. And this is going to be talking about the captivity of some of the kings of Israel, King Jehoahaz, King Jehoiakim. These are the collapsing kingdoms of the David's dynasty. And this all happened under Zedekiah. This is all stuff that happens in between 586 BC and 610 BC. So a little bit of history, but the main point that you're going to capture today is not a history lesson. What you're going to capture today is it is sad when people disobey the Lord. Good things never happen, right? Good things never happen when you disobey the Lord. And this is the Lord speaking of leaders of Israel and how he's going to lament them. So let's begin in verse 1. And I'm just going to read verse 1 and kind of lay this out a little bit more. Verse 1 says in Ezekiel 19, "And you take up a lamentation for the princes of Israel." A lamentation is like a sad, sorrowful song. Sing a sorrowful song for the condition of Israel. And we've been using all the previous chapters of Ezekiel to describe that condition. So you should know the condition of Israel quite well by this point. And it's not good. It's not good. This is sometimes sung, these kind of songs are sometimes sung at a funeral. So this is kind of the context. God is saying, lament over the state of Israel. And he's already pronounced his judgment. And so this can kind of be seen as lament. Sing a song about the death of Israel. Sing a song about the horrific condition of Israel. So this is the Lord expressing his sadness over Israel, but specifically here, over the failure of the leaders of Israel to do what is right in his eyes. And just to capture that for a second, remember this. God is the one who decides what is right. Not you and not me, but God. Immortal, always existing, all-powerful God is the one who decides what's right. So what is right is what is right in God's eyes. And anything that is not right in God's eyes is wrong. Right? Wrong. Anything that's not right in God's eyes is wrong. And so that is a great little thing to remember as you litmus test everything that you go through throughout your day. Is this right in God's eyes? If the answer is no, then it's wrong. It's very simple, right? And anything that is not right in God's eyes is sin. So if it's not right in God's eyes, it's wrong and it's sin. God's talking about the leaders here, and he's referring to them as princes of Israel. He referred to them in another way in a moment here. But this is concerning, this lamentation, this lament is concerning the later kings of Israel. The fall of Israel and its kings. Now, this is all going to be undone by the great King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, who will fulfill all of God's promises to David and to his ancestors through Christ. But this is going to be one of those examples of, here's what happens when mankind is left on his own. Right? We fail. We do what is wrong. So God here is calling these kings, they were kings, but God's calling them princes. He's doing that as kind of a little snub towards them. So this is a lamentation or a lament for kings, but God's referring to them as princes as Israel because he of their wickedness. You're not even acting like kings, so I won't even refer to you by that title, is the idea that God is putting forth here. So you have a descendants of David occupying the throne in Jerusalem. And you could hope, as long as that's going, you could say, hey, everything's going fine, right? And that would have been one of the things that the people would have been pointing to. And remember, we've talked this through Ezekiel, that, hey, false teachers and prophets were saying, everything's fine, there's no reason to worry, there's nothing wrong. Oh, the Babylonians are coming and they're taking us away. It's fine, everything's fine. And everybody was, they were lying. They were saying everything's fine, but God was saying through his true prophets, everything's not fine. Repent. Come back to me. Put your faith and trust in me. But they weren't doing that. And so here God is talking about the leaders who were contributing to that problem. Verse 2. And this is how God is going to refer to these same princes. They're kings, but he refers to them as princes as a little snub to them because they're not acting like the kings they should. And so now he's going to refer to them as other things too and bring their mother into this as well. So starting in verse 2 it says, "And say, what was your mother? A lioness. Among lions she crouched. In the midst of young lions she reared her cubs. And she brought up one of her cubs. And he became a young lion. And he learned to catch prey. He devoured men. The nations heard about him. He was caught in their pit. And they brought him with hooks to the land of Egypt." So just in verses 2 through 4, it's talking about a lioness. And it's talking about a mighty lion that's taken captive to Egypt. This is a prophetic section of scripture, so you can count on this coming to pass at some point. So Judah is the lioness here in this part. And her cubs are going to be the imagery used to show her descendants, the descendants of David, and how they're going to be influenced and what's going to happen to them. This is the mother of the princes mentioned in those verses. So the lioness is Judah. You could say the lioness is Israel or Jerusalem itself. Takes its place amongst the community of nations. But this is a personification really of Judah. A lion of Judah. A proverbial term used in Ezekiel's day. Kind of like how you say the Russian bear. Right? Russian bear, strong. This is the lion of Judah. This is the idea that's being connected here. You might not know this, but lions were actually common in Palestine until after the Crusades. And so that's why you find them used so much in Old Testament scripture. So this lioness, Jerusalem, Judah, brings up one of her cubs. And this is referring to one of the kings that I mentioned at the very beginning. This is referring to Jehoazaz. He is a son of King Josiah. And you find him mentioned in Jeremiah 22. He does not reign long. He reigns only a few months. When it mentions in verses 2 through 4 that this young lion devoured men, it is a way of God telling us that not only was his reign short, but it was brutal. Evil. Don't forget, God's not talking these guys up. He's already referred to them as princes, which is a snub because they were technically kings. But God's referring to them as princes because, hey, you didn't act like a king. So I'm not even going to refer to you by that title. And so this Jehoazaz, his reign is short, but it's brutal. It's murderous. He shows that he's fierce and cruel. This is shown in 2 Kings chapter 23. Ends up that this bad king is brought with chains to the land of Egypt. He is taken from Judah and imprisoned in Egypt in 609 BC, again found in 2 Kings 23. This is after a very short 3-month reign. And he was trapped in their pit. Many times in the ancient days, if you had a lion trapped or a tiger trapped, a dangerous animal trapped, you would throw him into a pit. And that's what happens to this young man. He is thrown into a pit just like a wild beast, taken by force from the land of Judah by Pharaoh to Egypt. Now, there's another line. Remember, we mentioned two kings that God referred to as princes. And then in verse 5 through 7, it says this. When she saw that she waited in vain, that her hope was lost, she took another of her cubs and made him a young lion. Okay, so you see what happens here to Jehoahaz. Well, now the lioness who represents Judah, who represents Israel, is going to pick another lion because that other lion's not coming back. When she saw that her waiting was in vain, that her hope was lost, she took another of her cubs and made him a young lion. He prowled amongst the lions. He became a young lion, and he learned to catch prey, and he devoured men and seized their widows. He laid waste their cities, and the land was appalled, and all who were in it at the sound of his roaring. This is referring to King Jehoiakim. He reigned right after his brother from 609 to 597. And he also was like his brother in the sense that he was brutal. And it's mentioned here that he was like a young lion himself and he devoured men. He was brutal as well. Same pack, right? Sometimes you see that you get from one group of, maybe a lion has a bunch of cubs or a dog has a bunch of puppies, right? And sometimes those puppies will share the same tendencies or those cubs will share the same tendencies. Same thing here. He shared the same tendencies. He had the same miseries. He was no better than his predecessor. For a time, he seemed to rule with power and authority, which is what it's talking about, how he made their places desolate. He laid waste their cities. He took their widows captive. For a time, it looks like he has power. For a time, it looks like he will be full of authority. And others were affected by his roaring. They heard of him and what he was doing. But let's see what happens to him. Spoiler alert. It's not going to be good. Okay, why? Because he's not being obedient to God. And you don't have to be a king of Judah to be able to fall into that category. This is a truth that applies to all people. You can expect bad things if you disobey God and turn from him. If you give him the cold shoulder and say, I do not care what you want or what you say, at some point, you are going to have to pay up. At some point, you will reap what you sow because God is not mocked. At some point, you are going to have to pay the fiddler. It will come to pass. So let's see what happens to this young lion. Verse 8. Then the nations set against him from providences on every side. They spread their net over him, and he was taken in their pit. With hooks they put him in a cage and brought him to the king of Babylon. They brought him into custody that his voice should no more be heard on the mountains of Israel. So when Jehoiakim is rebelling and going against the Babylonian rulers like Nebuchadnezzar, he brings an army against him and takes all his other providences that are underneath his control and comes against him and captures him. They put him in a cage with chains and brought him to the king of Babylon. He's brought to as a prisoner. This is Jehoiakim. He's brought as a prisoner to Babylon in 597 BC, and he never returns. That is, his voice will no longer be heard in the mountains of Israel. If I say to you, Michael's beautiful baritone voice will no longer be heard in the town of Dover, you understand what I'm saying. I'll never come back to Dover, right? That's what that sentence means. So when this says, his voice shall no longer be heard on the mountains of Israel, that means this king ain't ever coming back. Okay, that's what God's prophesying. And when God prophesies something, he's not just saying, I think this is going to happen. God is the one who decrees everything. He is completely sovereign. So when God says this is going to happen or that's going to happen, it's not a maybe. It's not like a horoscope you read in the Times Reporter, okay? This is God. He is saying exactly how he is going to make it come about. So you know this is going to happen. They were tired of his roaring, tired of his predatory nature. Pretty amazing. This is another one of her cubs, also taken away. Verse 10. Your mother was like a vine in a vineyard planted by the water, fruitful and full of branches by reason of abundant water. Its strong stems because rulers' scepters. It towered aloft among the thick boughs. It was seen in its height with the mass of its branches. Huh? What? I can almost feel that coming from your brains. Huh? What? Where? Huh? What about the lions? Now we're talking about vines? What's going on? Vines and waters and boughs and what? So now this is just a different type of imagery. We're still in the same context, just a different type of imagery being used. Now the very familiar imagery of a vine. Israel is now, instead of being referred to as a lioness, Israel is now being referred to as a vine. See? So now this is going to help a lot. Now that you understand that, okay, the imagery has changed. We're still talking about the same stuff, but now the imagery has changed. Instead of a lioness, we're talking about a vine. So the picture is of a fruitful and strong kingdom. Israel was a fruitful and strong kingdom at one point. She had strong branches for scepters of rulers. No doubt this is describing, you know, the glory days of Israel. In the peak of its strength with David and Solomon. In those years, God lifted up Israel amongst the nations that surrounded it. And God blessed Israel in so many ways that it towered in stature. This is what it's referring to. So this is kind of showing you, again, same context. A lament about the condition of Israel. And now this is a remembrance of, do you remember how it used to be? Do you remember how great it used to be? When we towered in stature? When you were like a vine full of branches next to many waters? And your branches were strong? See the contrast? And what God is saying through Ezekiel here is, when you had men who were after my own heart, when you had men who looked to follow my ways, granted, imperfect, right? Because every man is imperfect. But it wasn't about the perfection of these rulers, King David and King Solomon. It was their direction. When they sinned, they repented, right? And so it was direction and faith. And God's saying, look back to the glory days, and that was when you had men of faith on the throne. And now look at you. You no longer have men of faith on the throne. And now how far have you fallen? It's a contrast. Verse 12. But, here's that contrast. But the vine was plucked up in fury and cast down to the ground. The east wind dried up its fruit. They were stripped off and withered. As for its strong stem, fire consumed it. Now it's planted in the wilderness. It's been scattered. In a dry and thirsty land, the fire has gone out from the stem of its shoots and has consumed its fruit so that it remains in it no strong stem, no scepter for ruling. This is a lamentation and has become a lamentation. This is true of Israel from that moment that it happens, and still true of it today. No one has gathered up the scepter regarding Israel. And you know who's going to be the one to do it? Christ. Christ will be the one to do it. When he picks up that scepter, so to speak, he will be the final person to do it. And his reign will be perfect and it will be eternal. But here it's talking about that contrast, right? Remember your glory days, Israel? You remember what it was like? But now you were like a vine that was so strong and had so many branches and boughs, and you were near water and you were strong and you had much stature. But now your vine has been plucked up in fury. In other words, there was a day when God blessed Israel. Now there's a day where God no longer blesses Israel and its kings because they consistently rebelled against God. You do not have to sit down and write a letter. This goes for nations and this goes for people. You don't need to sit down and write an actual letter and say, "Dear God, I hereby convey to you, I choose to rebel." Signed, X. You don't have to do that. You don't have to have those words come out of your mouth. Because that's a lot of what people will do is they say, well, look, I've never said that I'm a rebel of God. No, you've never said it. You've never said those words out loud. But your lives and what you do and what you think and what you say show that you are a rebel against God. And what's happening here is that God says, I will no longer bless those who rebel against me. And he's talking about Israel. So many individuals within Israel were sinfully rebelling against God in their individual lives that God is now going to judge them as a whole. And so Israel's cast down to the ground as a result of God's judgment. Strong branches broken and withered. This is the idea of like, look, you had strong kings. You had David. You had Solomon. Now we're talking about Jehoiakim. Weak. No more strong kings. Because all your strong branches have withered. They're broken. Now you're planted in the wilderness. God took this vine that he had close to streams and had strong and big vine that was so luscious and so strong. Now he's taken that and transplanted that vine and put it out in the wilderness. The idea is that he's taken it from the blessed place and put it somewhere else. Nebuchadnezzar was in Babylon, and that's where they were planted. It's not the literal wilderness, but it's not their home. It's not where they belong, so it's a wilderness to them. Fire comes out, the rod of her branches, and the fruit devoured. The worst damage to the vine comes from its own branches. Isn't that true? The corruption and destruction comes from within. Remember what we talked about last time? About how the people were trying to blame their forefathers and blame everybody else but themselves. But corruption comes from within. This is why you will never find the answer to being right with God. If everyone is rebelling against God, how do you get right with God? If no one is at peace with God, if everyone's a sinner, how do you get right with God? I'll tell you how you don't. You don't find it from within, because that's where corruption comes from. So you go out in the middle of the wilderness and you sit on a big white rock and you meditate all day long and you think inwardly and you try and find the answer within, you won't find it. Because the only thing that's within you is sin, sinful nature, and corruption. That's what's in us. That's what's in us. The answer is without us. It's outside of us. The answer is faith in God, which we now have the fully revealed Word of God in the Bible. And that tells us that the answer is Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life, according to John 14:6. So that's how. And he's not inside us, he's outside of us. So the answer isn't within, the answer is without. Destructive fire comes from within. This is what happens to Israel as well. No longer a strong branch, no scepter for ruling. You have Zedekiah, the last of the kings in the line of David, until Jesus comes. And when Jesus comes, he is in the line of David. He has the right to sit on the throne. He has the right to hold the scepter, and he is perfectly obedient to God. So not only shall he be blessed, but all those underneath him shall be blessed. This is a lamentation. This is a lament. This is the tragedy of Israel, the tragedy of Judah. It's tragic when people who have heard and know the truth turn from it. That's tragic. That's the most tragic. It's tragic when someone who has never heard the gospel and have never heard the truth of God's word, it's tragic when they pass and die. But there's something more tragic about someone who is around it, someone who has heard it, someone who has been witness to it, and yet still turns. This is why when God talks of Israel and rebelling Israel, he condemns them more harshly than their pagan neighbors, because he says, you act even worse than your pagan neighbors, and you have the revealed truth. There's even more judgment on someone for that, because you have more truth. You knew the truth and still chose to disobey. That's worse. That's worse. So this is why it's a lamentation. This is a lament. This is a don't do this story. There's been destruction that's already been carried out even. This is how sinful we are as humans. There has been destruction and ruin already carried out at this point, and there are still people walking around in Ezekiel's day saying, everything's fine, everything's fine. No need to repent. No need to admit our sin. Everything that's happening to us can't be because of my actions. It's because of the actions of my forefathers. Remember Ezekiel 18? They tasted the sour grapes. They bit into them, but we got the sour taste in our mouth. That was them trying to shirk their responsibility. What a shameful thing, and how lament-worthy is that? They knew of God. They knew of his power. They witnessed his exodus from Egypt. Their forefathers told them of the miracles that God had done for them. They had the most truth of anyone on the planet at the time, and they still, some of them, chose to turn and rebel from God. This is a lamentation for what has already happened to them because of their rebellious nature, but it's also a lamentation of this is what's going to come. It's both. If the nation of Israel had obeyed the Lord, it would have still been blessed by him and still been protected, still remained a mighty lion, still remained a strong vine with great branches, and it would have brought glory to the Lord in being in that position. Instead, they rebel, and they end up bringing glory to the Lord through his judgment of them. And make no mistake, God is glorified either way. If someone who refuses to believe in God shakes their fist at him, spits on his word, and says, I will never yield to you, and that person dies and stands before the great white throne of God and is told that they are now going to spend all eternity in the lake of fire, and they are sent there by a holy, just, and righteous God, and that happens to that person, God is glorified. God is glorified by carrying out his perfect, holy justice. Because that person's sinfulness and their refusal to take the one way that God has given for mercy has allowed that to happen. And God is glorified in the giving and doling out of his justice as just as much as he is glorified by the doling out of his mercy. Both attributes of God are worthy to be praised. God is worthy to be praised for his holiness and his righteousness and his justice. And God is worthy to be praised for his grace, his mercy, and his love. All those attributes glorify God and are praiseworthy. God will be glorified for the sinners that he has saved and will turn into saints by the righteousness of Christ being given to them by faith alone. And God will be glorified in the doling out of his perfect justice to those who are not saved. Either way, God will be glorified. So it makes sense to me when I hear this that those are the only two options. It's a very clear choice, especially when we understand that it's the Lord who has made it all, and it's the Lord who has presented us with only those two choices. Please pray with me. What a good reminder, Lord, that we should seek to be obedient to you and trusting in you and your word so that we might be blessed and that we might glorify you and serve you well. Help us to not forget all the things that you have done. You've done so many things that we recount in your word, the Bible. From Old Testament to New, we read all these stories of your power and your faithfulness. But Lord, you have done so many things in our own lives and in the lives of those around us. Help us not forget those things. Help us to not be like rebellious, unbelieving Israel, who in spite of seeing and experiencing and hearing all those things, despite all the knowledge that they had, they still chose to rebel against you. Help us to not rebel against you. As believers, Lord, we have already yielded to you and submitted to you, but there's still, even though we have yielded and submitted to you, there are still ways that we rebel against you, tiny little ways that we rebel against you every day. Help those to come to an end. Help us to stop rebelling against you. Whatever part of our sinful flesh, whatever part of our old selves that we hold on to or that we still are battling, please help us to gain victory over it. As a matter of fact, you will have to gain the victory over it because it's something we cannot do. We want to be not hypocritical Christians, but genuine Christians who say, when we say we love you and we love your word, we want every one of our thoughts, words, and deeds to prove that to be true. And we know that we won't be perfect this side of heaven, but Lord, we pray that you would help us grow as much in Christ-likeness now before you call us home as possible, so that we might glorify you and that we might point others towards Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray and thank you. Amen.